We're a lot further ahead with the financial reform programme than we had expected, say, 2 years, certainly 5 years ago. The programme can, I think, seem very fragmentary. Yes. So we have this sort of alphabet soup, really, of individual pilots and quotas.
So at one level, it's all very confusing. We have QFEE, we've got RQFEE, we've got the QDII schemes, we've now got four FTZs, there's Stock Connect, all the rest of it. What links it all together? Well, there is an underlying roadmap, and that's nothing short of the opening of China's capital account. Each of these schemes actually targets a particular item of China's capital account, and out of the 40 items recognised by the IMF, we're now at the stage in which, by means of all these schemes linking together, only 5 items of China's capital account remain completely closed.
We talk about convertibility of the renminbi, and when will that come to pass. It's quite clear, I think, now that the grand plan does not involve anything like the free convertibility of a currency which we're very used to in the West.
So what's going to happen next? Well, 2015 promises to be a very busy year. We're expecting 2 new developments. The first will be the targeting of the 5 capital account items which remain closed. So new schemes will be brought in, which will allow individual investors to move capital in and out of China. So far, the schemes have really focused on the institutional investor. And secondly, we'll have a scheme which permits non-residents to access China's capital markets directly. So that will open the door to things like panda bonds and possibly the ability of multinational corporates to do an IPO or a secondary listing on the Shanghai Stock Exchange.
The renminbi will be used internationally as a currency in the same way as the US dollar and the euro. And what that means is we will have a key piece of infrastructure, the China International Payment System.
The second major development will be the rollout of infrastructure, a new payment system, which will allow the renminbi to be settled outside China in exactly the same way as the US dollar, the British pound and the euro are now settled using People's Bank of China at the centre. That will overcome, I think, a lot of the current confusion about what this offshore renminbi really is and how the different offshore clearing banks operate together.
What lessons can we learn from the Shanghai Free Trade Zone? And where will that take us? Why don't you start, Andrew?
Yes, I think the very fact that you're asking the question indicates a certain level of disappointment internationally, certainly relative to the, as you say, the initial fanfare.
Right.
I don't think it would be right, though, to think that nothing has been going on. What's been happening since the announcement is the progressive working out of the implementing regulations. And there are some extremely important pilots being rolled out in the free trade zone.
So what does this mean for Luxembourg? Well, at one level, Luxembourg is going to operate on the same basis as other financial centres. It has a very deep pool of professionals, bankers, lawyers, accountants, and it's really a question of harnessing the expertise resident in Luxembourg to make the most of the clearing bank and the RQFEE quota. So a question of designing and rolling out renminbi-denominated products to allow European corporates to hedge, to invest and to finance in the renminbi. At a deeper level, though, China's really interested in what Luxembourg has to offer as a centre of the global asset management industry. So the ability of Luxembourg to use its resources to channel funds, globally available funds, through its investment products and through the existing schemes into China, and also to provide a distribution channel for investment out of China into existing European funds. I think that's the major advantage which the PRC authorities are very keen to see implemented by Luxembourg.